please.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Gringas and Dr. Galao. And again, it's a pleasure to be here. A little bit early in the morning, I know it starts quiet, but I know by the end of this lecture, it'll probably be packed. There are tons of people coming. And so I'm going to talk about ventricular septal defects, but I think in the context of this session, which it seems like is going to be talking about closure, medical versus surgical, so I wanted to set the table, as we say in English, for that, really in that regard. Disclosures, I have no disclosures relevant to this presentation. However, I did train with Dr. Richard and Stella Van Prague and Boston, so I know a lot of people have talked about Boston and Van Prague's versus Andersonians, and I just want to let you know that I will be using a lot of Van Prague terminology, and I apologize for that, although I shouldn't apologize, because I really dearly love those two. I'm going to talk about the anatomy of ventricular septal defects, nomenclature, morphology, and conduction system, try to fold it all at one. Talk a little bit about VSDs and considerations for device closure, though I think the other speakers will talk more about that. And then the question about when to close a VSD, which I think most of us know, but I want to present a little bit of data. I hope I have the time to be able to do that. I will focus on VSDs by themselves. That is, they are the primary lesion. There can be an ASD, but really it's about VSDs. I am not going to talk about VSDs in association with more complex congenital heart defects, such as tetralogy flow or DORV so much. Anything with AV, bad, abnormal AV and VA connections. I just want to talk about VSDs themselves. And some of this information you all kind of already know, but for some of the trainees, we know that VSDs really is, essentially is a communication between the two ventricles, which we call it ventricular septal defect, but we know sometimes the Andersonians call it an interventricular communication. It is one of the most common, if not the most common, form of congenital heart disease, up to 40%. The important things to realize is that there can be more than one type of defect present in one patient, and it can be part of several complex malformations, as I've noted before. Now, when we think about typical classification, and I know I think everyone kind of knows, shares these classifications, probably the top four in yellow over here, perimembranous, AV canal / inlet, muscular, and outlet supracrystal, are the ones people think about most. There are so-called malalignment VSDs. There's so-called intramural VSDs, which I talked about last year in conference here. I will not talk about this time. And then traumatic and post-infarct. These are some of the other types of VSDs. But we're really going to focus on the top three, the top four over here. Now we, again, Van Prague and Anderson have slightly different different terminology for basically the same lesions over here, okay? So there's, you know, what one calls a conal, one will call doubly committed, et cetera, et cetera. And so we know that there's some contrast in terms of the nomenclature, and that's important. It hasn't really been settled. In fact, if you look at a table of different types of classifications, you can find so many different types of ways to call these four types of VSDs over here. And again, I will focus on the Van Prague and Andersonian classifications, but I wanted to point out the ISN-PCHD. This is a paper that just came out in Annals of Thoracic Surgery back in 2018. It's the International Society for the Nomenclature of Pediatric and Congenital Heart Disease. This came out of a working group that was formed in 2002 after the World Congress in Toronto to try and establish some type of uniformity in terms of nomenclature and classification. Although, again, I think most people can kind of figure out one from the other. But what it did was it tried to provide a universal classification scheme based on geography, that is perimembranous, inlet, trabecular and muscular, trabecular and muscular and outlet, but also emphasize, which is very important, the borders to facilitate understanding, that is the relationship of the VSTs to the AV valves, membranous septum, muscular septum, arterial valves, and also highlight areas of fibrous continuity between the AV and arterial valves. This is a table from that, and really what I wanted to point out is that you can see there's still the four major classifications. That hasn't changed, but they tried to give a little bit of different terminology, tried to include the areas around it. They also included malalignment, too. They talked about outlet VSDs without malalignment, which we would call supracrystal or subpulmonary, as well as outlet VSDs with malalignment, and they try to fold that into it too. So, but basically, just know that we still have these four major classifications, but there are different ways that people are trying to have talked about it or termed it. And again, the ISN-PCHD, this most recent one, does the same thing, but gives slightly different terminology. We also know that certain ones are more common. Certainly in the United States, we look at perimembranous VSDs or membranous VSDs as the most common, about 80% of all defects, with about muscular and inlet type VSDs being another 10 to 20%, or sometimes, as well as supracrystal VSDs, only about 5 to 7% in the United States, though certainly much more common here in Asia, I know. And this sort of goes to locations. I think what's really important for us to, when we think about VSDs and understand it, is to remember what the normal anatomy is, and that's what's emphasized in all the papers, is that you really have to remember what is the anatomy. Now, yesterday, I remember some of the speakers talking about the trabecular septum, the septal band, or some people, or as Andersonians call it, the trabecular septum marginalis, the outlet septum or conal septum, the parietal band or ventricular infundibular fold. These are all the different parts of the right ventricle, and whether you call it one or the other, it's important to remember what these different portions are. And the other thing, too, is the conduction system. It begins here, the triangle of Koch, and travels through, really, posterior to the membranous septum over here, and then divides into the penetrating bundle, into the left side, into the right side, and then, of course, the right bundle comes along, travels along the septal band, out into the moderator band, and out to the anterior papillary muscle. So it's really important to remember that, because that, I'm going to show you some other diagrams that kind of discuss this. The other thing about the membranous septum, as we all know, it's the thinnest portion of the septum. It is the one that is most prone to have defects, like I said, about 80% of defects. This is an actual specimen in which you transilluminate, and you can see really nicely, there is that membranous septum right over here. The conduction system will be traveling right underneath it. And this, of course, you can't see the septal band and the conal septum because they're one, and I think one of the speakers pointed that out yesterday. This is another specimen which shows that membranous septum. And the other thing that's really important when you think about VSDs is to think about them both on the right ventricular side as well as the left ventricular side too. So looking from the left ventricular side, here's that membranous septum we talked about before, and it's right beneath the commissure between the right and non-coronary cusp, and look how close it is to the aortic valve, and also here's the fibrous continuity between the aortic valve and the mitral valve. This is that same specimen, but looking for the left ventricle, again, that transilluminated membranous septum. And again, the conduction system we talked about before, really the normal conduction system traverses underneath or posterior to the membranous septum. That's usually the case with most of these VSDs we're talking about. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about the central perimembranous. We're going to divide those four up, and I'm going to try and go over those individually and show some examples of that, too. Central perimembranous, again, 80% of the defects. We also know it as membranous, perimembranous, paramembranous, conoventricular, type 2 defects, okay? It's located in the center at the base of the heart, vicinity of the membranous septum, as I said, at the anteroseptal commissure between the septal leaflet of the tricuspid valve, between the right and non-coronary cusps of the aortic valve on the left-hand side, and below and behind the posterior inferior limb of septal band. Usually an area of fibrous continuity between the aortic valve and semilunar valve. In some instances, there may be a complete muscular border surrounding it. It can extend to the inlet or outlet septum. So that's a very important point, is that the cross-sectional shape may not be regular, may not be round, it may be very irregular. Tricuspid valve septal leaflet can divert flow into the right atrium. It can cover it. It can partially or completely close it. Sometimes it produces a windsock aneurysm, which I'll show in a moment, which sometimes we try and close with interventional techniques. So here's that perimembranous VSD, again, from that same paper from the Anesthothoracic Surgery 2018, again, with the conductions going right posterior to. This is a very dangerous area over here. Surgeons have to be very careful. I won't say dangerous, but they have to be very careful so that they don't cause heart block if they put the stitches over here. And this is kind of how it looks like, right here in between the commissure between the septal and anterior leaflets. And it is, again, below the level of the septal band over here in the rightward limb of the septal band. Now, I just wanted to show that sometimes it can extend in different directions. This shows it a little bit, but I think this diagram shows it best of all. There's a perimembranous VSD, extension to the outlet, extension to the trabecular septum, and extension down into the inlet septum. But what you can see over here is it can have a very unusual configuration. And this is an example of a VSD, a true perimembranous VSD from our specimens, between the right non-coronary cusp from the left ventricle. Remember I said it was underneath it there, small rim there, close to the aortic valve, has a kind of a teardrop type of configuration, and that same VSD from the right ventricular side, too. So again, in that very typical location. This is an example of a windsock type aneurysm there, and sometimes there's a little bit of a hole here. This is what we in the U.S. were trying to close using some type of device instead of actually putting in the VSD itself, but putting in the pouch that is formed over here. This is a Gerbode defect over here. We know that sometimes the flow can be diverted out across the septal tissue and out into the right atrium too, causing a left ventricular to right atrial shunt. I think we all kind of know about that as well. And this can produce sometimes a fairly significant amount of left to right shunting. There it is right there. Going to the inlet VSDs, we all know that the inlet VSDs are also known as the AV canal type defects, the perimembranous defect with inlet extension, the type 3 defect. And this is a VSD that sometimes can overlap with the membranous VSDs and be hard to tell. It extends a little bit more inferior and posterior behind the septal leaflet of the tricuspid valve, below the anterior septal commissure of the tricuspid valve, and below this posterior limb of the septal band. It can extend into the membranous septum, and that's why I say sometimes it can be confused or it kind of merges with a perimembranous VSD. But it can also have complete muscular borders, and it may or may not have malalignment of the atrial ventricular septum. AV canal type VSD sometimes can have some malalignment between atrial ventricular septum so that there can be straddling of an AV valve, and that, of course, can have important implications for closure in the cath lab. The location of the conduction system, again, is posterior, but can vary depending on the margins of the VSD. So this is one in which there's actually extension of the perimembranous septum, the membranous septum over here. So it's a little bit lower, but next to the septal leaflet tricuspid valve, but then extends up into the membranous septum. So it's quite a large defect. You can see that the conduction system is right below this margin here, comes up. And so that's an important point here too. This can be a difficult defect to close in the interventional lab because you don't know exactly where your margins are over here and whether you're going to entrap something. This is one in which there's actually a complete muscular rim. This would lend itself a little bit more to closure. And you can see there's complete muscularization. Now, the interesting thing about this defect is it's lower down. Some might say that this is merging into the mid-muscular septum. But notice that the conduction system here is anterior to this defect. Because this defect is so low, it goes below where the conduction system is, and there is a complete muscular rim. And this is one in which there's malalignment that occurs. This is one in which you can actually have malalignment between the atrium and ventricular septum. This patient also had a straddling of the valve, of the tricuspid valve going across. And the problem with this one is that a lot of times it's very deep, very long, very large. There may or may not be straddling, but a lot of times the conduction system is very low and inferior to this border here, so that making closure problematic if you have to be careful about putting sutures in this area just because you have to be careful of the conduction system. Muscular VSDs, I think these are the ones that we think about a lot when you want to close. We also know them as trabecular muscular defects. That's the newest terminology, that's what they're named. Type 4 defects, and these ones have exclusive muscular borders. They are often classified by location, anterior, posterior, mid, or apical. They can be complex with multiple exit points, and that's one of the most important things about these defects, is that sometimes their entrance points are different than their exit points. They can appear different from the RV and LV aspects. They produce a trabecular appearance, and they have malalignment of the ventricular septum. They can vary by size and shape, and the cross-sectional shape may not be round, as I said before. There can be multiple locations, also known as the Swiss cheese defect, and their location is generally remote from the conduction system. So just showing some of these defects over here, here's some anterior muscular VSDs, there's an apical muscular VSD, there's a mid-muscular VSD, there's kind of a posterior VSD here. Note that they're all remote from the conduction system, really in the mass of the ventricular septum itself. And this is from some of our specimens showing a very large kind of mid-muscular VSD that is really, really, really large, showing from the right ventricular side and the left ventricular side over here. This is another specimen of ours that shows multiple VSDs. This is a Swiss cheese VSD with one large VSD. It looks like it extends in the inlet and membranous septum. There's a mid-muscular. It's probably one a little bit lower. There may down a little bit lower here. And looking from the left ventricular side, I actually think that there might be one a little bit more posterior. I don't quite remember. There's that big inlet muscular membranous one, and then there's a mid-muscular one too. So this is what you would call Swiss cheese type of VSD. This is a 3D echo just to show, look at these VSDs. They're more slit-like over here, and then there's a perimembranous VSD in a patient with transposition of the great arteries. And look how different this VSD looks from the left side as opposed to the right side. And there, this one has actually a little bit of bar bisecting it too. Again, showing that it looks different sometimes from the left ventricular side than from the right ventricular side. And then this all is just this is a still frame over here that I pulled up from the web. I didn't have one. That shows that sometimes you can have a malalignment in parts of the septum too. And so the reason why you have the defect is because it doesn't all come together. And these can be a little bit more difficult sometimes to close.
Pierre, 2 minutes.
Oh, sorry about that. Doubly committed supracrystal VSDs, also known as juxta-arterial, subpulmonary, and subconal septal VSDs, are located between the limbs of the septal band, and these are absent conal septum. And this is where the right coronary cusp can prolapse through the defect and extend to the other side. So this is what the defect looks like over here, large. And really what you do is you have fibrous continuity between the aortic and pulmonary valves. And because of that, and I'm just going to go over this real quickly over here, you can actually have essentially no conal septum septum is all, as you can see right here. So I've got to move a little quickly because I don't have much time left, so I'm just going to show this. And the VSD, as we know from paracentral short axis, is between 12 and 2 o'clock over here. So the important considerations about VSD, again, location, adjacent structures, size, rim stank of the defect, number of defects in their locations, and whether there's a straddling AV valve tissue. Very important. And I think the ones that lend themselves most likely to closure are muscular, perimembranous, and this, maybe the supracrystal. That's hard to know. When should we close a VSD? The classic undisputed indications include heart failure. I think we know these, poor weight gain, a QPS, QS greater than 2, and associated defects. However, we also know that sometimes patients, if they have a QPQS less than 1.5, no evidence of pulmonary hypertension, no evidence of left atrial, left ventricular dislocation, and usually muscular paramyxoid location, we usually leave them alone. So I only have a little bit of time left, so I just want to say there is a gray area over here in which we don't know sometimes what the QPQS is, and we are trying to figure that out. But I wanted to show this one study over here that was very interesting that just came out, really in 2017. This is a study in Denmark, which is a prospective study in which they actually looked at adult patients, 26 and a half years about, and compared to 25 healthy individuals. All the VSD patients had, they didn't say what type it was, QPQS less than 1.5 to 1, location of the VSD, VSTs was not given, and what they looked at is a functional capacity, and they found that there was a negative correlation between QPQS and peak VO2, with VSD patients having increased forward and retrograde flow and an increased pulmonary artery diameter. So this is kind of what it looked like over here. And these patients were asymptomatic and were in good shape over here. But their suggestion was that maybe there was a little bit more pulmonary hypertension and that might have reduced their functional capacity, even with a QPQS at rest of less than 1.5 to 1. By the way, that was measured by MRI. So the question is, does pulmonary artery pressure increase disproportionately in small VSD patients with exercise? And I thought this was interesting because this kind of goes against the conventional dogma that less than 1.5 to 1 we don't need to do anything about, but it raised some question about that too. So,
Pierre,
yes, I'm just about done here. So when we're assessing VSDs, it's essential to evaluate location, size, extension to other areas, and important structures adjacent to the VSD. Consider the conduction system, what type of VSDs might lend themselves to closure, and consider criteria that might qualify patients to be candidates for VSD closure. So again, I thank you very much for that.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much.